Hi everyone, I'm so pleased to be here. If I may, I want to begin by saying thank you to the officers of the Society, the Program Committee, Barbara Heritage, and Aaron Schreiner in particular. I should say thanks to former ESA New Scholars, John Garcia, Megan Pizer, and Mikael Waugh for their advice as I prepared this talk. And I also want to acknowledge my indebtedness to Rare Book School. This paper grew quite directly out of a class I took in Charlottesville in 2015 with Professor Michael Winship. While attending that course, I learned about the J.B. Lippincott archives, which led to a 2016 fellowship at the Library Company of Philadelphia and the Historical Society of Pennsylvania. This research became the basis for an additional chapter in my book project, from which this presentation is drawn. And the overall project considers interactions between major industrial trade publishers of the late 19th century and multi-ethnic authors or U.S. writers of color, what that relationship was like. Maria Amparo Ruiz de Burton, 1872, who would have thought it? The first known novel published in English by a Mexican-American author looks like any other book from J.B. Lippincott and Company at the time. Bound in blue cloth, the duodecimo volume has a simple rectangular pattern on the front cover, with the book title and publisher name in gold on the spine. The novel was published anonymously and sold at a retail price of $1.75. In the back of the copy of the book that is now held by the Library Company of Philadelphia, after the conclusion of the novel, there are 10 pages of advertisements for other J.B. Lippincott titles, including a full page that advertises novels by Ouida, the Anglo-French sensationalist. Who would have thought it was designed to fit alongside these novels? Its title echoes other titles published by Lippincott at this time, such as Must It Be and How Will It End? Because the novel was published anonymously, without reference to Ruiz de Burton or her background, and because it was not advertised with any description of its contents, the general reader would have purchased and begun reading the novel in terms of this sensational fiction. Indeed, Maria Amparo Ruiz de Burton orchestrated for her book to appear in this way. Yet while Ruiz de Burton's first novel was produced by one of the world's largest book distributors of the mid-19th century, little is known about the relationship between the author and the company. So in this presentation, I refer to Lippincott Company business records and correspondence to reconstruct a bit of the production and sale of this significant predecessor to Mexican-American fiction. I show that Ruiz de Burton hired J.B. Lippincott and Company because of their specialization in job printing. That is, their ability to produce and distribute books for a commission. In fact, the use of J.B. Lippincott as job printers cost Ruiz de Burton over $500. Yet it nevertheless allowed the author to establish a Mexican-American literary voice that could be heard across the nation. In this way, who would have thought it can be read as a sensationalist novel in camouflage, conveying the Latina consciousness in an anonymous yet impressively durable form. As one of the earliest writers of Mexican origin to write and publish novels in English in the United States, Ruiz de Burton occupies an important place in 19th century American and Latino culture. Born in 1832, she was raised by a wealthy landowning family in Baja, California, and she came of age at the time of the Mexican-American War. In 1848, after the war ended and the Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo was signed, Ruiz de Burton traveled with her mother as a refugee to the town of Monterey in Alta, California. There, at the age of 17, she became an American citizen, and she married U.S. Army Captain Henry S. Burton, hence Maria Amparo Ruiz de Burton. In the 1860s, she moved east as her husband served in the Union Army, living in Rhode Island, New York, Washington, D.C., Delaware, and Virginia. Ruiz de Burton socialized in elite circles at this time, but when her husband died in 1869, she returned to California a widow with two children. Ruiz de Burton wrote and published two novels in her lifetime, Who Would Have Thought It, published anonymously in 1872, and The Squatter and the Don, published under the pseudonym C. Loyal in 1885. She also wrote a comedic play, Don Quixote de la Mancha, staged in San Diego in the 1850s and published in 1876. Ruiz de Burton's novels and collected letters were recovered and republished from 1992 to 2001 by Rosara Sanchez and Beatrice Pita, and since that time her work has received increasing scholarly attention. Quick plot summary here. As a novel, who would have thought it follows the life of a young Mexican girl, Lola Medina, who's abducted by Sonoran Indians in California. Lola's mother has been forced into marriage with the native chief. Both women's skin has been dyed black so that they will not be recognized as kidnapped Mexicans. But they're discovered by a New England archaeologist, Dr. James Norlaw. Lola's mother explains their situation to Dr. Norlaw and describes how they have found they have a large fortune of gold, diamonds, and gems hidden nearby. So this was around the time of the gold rush, and the, you know, gems were even found and kind of discovered in California. Lola's mother asks Dr. Norlaw to serve as Lola's guardian until the girl can be reunited with her father in Mexico. He agrees, and the reader learns throughout the novel that Dr. Norlaw will honor his word. Upon returning to his New England home, however, Lola finds that Dr. Norlaw's family and servants are less trustworthy. While his son Julian, a Union Army officer, is sympathetic, Lola is confronted with harsh racist treatment from Dr. Norlaw's daughters, from the family's Irish servants, and especially from Dr. Norlaw's wife, Jemima Norlaw. Mrs. Norlaw is disgusted by the presence of Lola and wants nothing to do with the dark-skinned girl, despite her purported Christian and abolitionist beliefs. However, when Mrs. Norlaw learns of Lola's inheritance, she's overtaken with greed and begins conversations with a depraved minister. And the minister is a caricature of Henry Ward Beecher to find ways to steal Lola's fortune. Ultimately, at the novel's conclusion, Lola is reunited with her father in Mexico and marries Dr. Norlaw's son, Julian, who decides he'll travel there to live with him. So ultimately, the novel imagines a future defined by interracial marriage and alliances across the U.S.-Mexico border. In the mid-19th century, Lippincott, J.B. Lippincott, was known for its sheer size and its ability to manufacture all aspects of the book. In this 1852 article from Godey's Lady's Book, A Visit to the Book Bindery of Lippincott, Grambo & Company, engraver C.T. Hinckley describes the company as, quote, one of the largest publishing houses in the country, end quote. The article was part of a series on book production and was meant to cover only the book bindery at Lippincott. But as the introduction of the article describes, the author is so amazed by the amount of business performed and capital invested that he expanded the article to describe the Lippincott Company more broadly. As a company, Lippincott dates its origins back to 1792 through a series of mergers and, you know, business realignments. But Joshua Ballinger Lippincott himself was born in 1813 in New Jersey and began working in the Philadelphia book trade for David Clark and his teams. When Clark's business ran into financial difficulties, Lippincott was put in charge, and the company ran as Clark and Lippincott in the 1830s, before becoming J.B. Lippincott Company, Booksellers and Stationers in 1837. At that time. This company would then purchase Grigg, Elliott & Company in 1849, reorganized temporarily as Lippincott, Grambo & Company, before again establishing itself as J.B. Lippincott & Company. In 1861, the company moved to a large industrial facility at 715 717 Market Street. And in 1871, they added a large factory to the north on Filbert Street, annexed to the Market Street building on its first two floors. So this is that same building on the front, annexed to the factory on that. At this point, the Lippincott offices and factory covered more than 5 acres of land, quote, the largest establishment of its kind in the United States. And the company would remain here until 1899, when a fire destroyed the building. Indeed, there is a wonderful illustration of the building with a cutaway view of its various departments, including the retail store, shipping rooms, book bindery, and the magazine department. And I have to say thanks to Jim Green for pointing me to this. Who would have thought it was produced here in 1872, just 1 year after the Filbert Street factory began operation? In terms of various sections of the building, however, it was not produced for the publication department. That is, it wasn't selected by editors for publication, but rather through the job printing department. And down here with this little key, you can see that the publication department, I believe, is back here, and the job printing department is up here. So it would have been sold in a different section. And again, the company records show that Ruiz de Burton made an initial payment of $500 to have the novel published. It was long believed that the Lippincott company records had been lost in a fire and destroyed in the Market Street offices. As it turns out, however, the company had preserved many of its records in storage. And again, I have to say thank you to Michael Winship, who brought my attention to these records. So when the publisher in 1999, now Lippincott, Williams, and Wilkins, prepared to move offices, they initiated a donation of materials to the Historical Society of Pennsylvania. Over the span of 3 years, they donated 144 boxes of materials to the Historical Society. These records are not comprehensive, and their condition is also noteworthy. Many of the papers have suffered damage from water and mold over the years, and they've not yet been archivally arranged. So as I was in the Historical Society, they're in the cardboard moving boxes that they were donated in, and they're sort of stacked up and tied, and they have damage and mold, many of them. It also took some time before a preliminary finding aid was created by Michael Winship and Matthew Lyons in 2008, and then finalized and published by the Historical Society in March 2016. And so while these records are an incredibly valuable source of information for the study of 19th century publishing, they remain for the most part unexplored territory. Among these records, there are significant materials for understanding the publication of Who Would Have Thought. There are ledgers that show the costs of production and the sales figures for this early Mexican-American novel. There are records that show how many copies of the book J.B. Lippincott, the company, kept in stock. There are press letter books that includes select correspondence sent from Lippincott to Ruiz de Burton over the span of 20 years. So this image is from a double entry counting book, and it describes the production and then the sale of Who Would Have Thought It. The costs of production are on the verso page 466, and the revenue generated by the book is on the recto. The entry shows that in June of 1872, Lippincott produced 750 copies of the novel at a total cost of $1,015. The stereotype plates cost $636, the stamp on the spine cost $7.50, manufacturing book cost 49 cents per copy. All copies of the book were bound and none were left as sheets. Ruiz de Burton paid the company $500 on May 13th before production began, which was transferred to the Lippincott cash account. I don't know if this is legible, but and so these are the sales on the other side of the book. On December 31st, 1872, when Lippincott reported biannual sales, they had sold 400 copies of the novel, and Ruiz de Burton was credited $350. $350 is here, I think, for sales. The round sales figure, precisely 400, suggests that Lippincott may have sold these copies at the publisher's trade auction. And notably, the account provides more detailed information for special mailings sent out to editors and particular individuals. Shortly after these initial 400 copies were sold, in January of 1873, J.B. Lippincott and Company wrote to Ruiz de Burton, and they asked her to pay the difference between the cost of production and the $850 she had been credited for the novel. In other words, Ruiz de Burton was responsible for all costs of publication, and she owed the company money even after she had paid the initial $500 and they had sold 400 copies. She did not pay this money, however, and she never would. She allowed additional sales to be credited to her account. And so when sales are recorded again on June 30th of 1873, the book had sold an additional 79 copies, reducing the amount owed. In the decade between 1874 and January 1883, however, the book sells only 28 additional copies. The company held remaining copies of Ruiz de Burton's novel in the warehouse until they were destroyed by the fire in November 1899. In 1900, after that fire, the company reimbursed itself for Ruiz de Burton's debt by insurance, or what is labeled a contingency fund within the records. Much more than they broke even on this account, the Lippincott profited from the novel. While who would have thought it sold at a retail price of $1.75, Ruiz de Burton was only credited 87.5 cents per copy sold. And this is why 400 copies earned for only $350. The Lippincott ledgers describe their accounting method saying, we account sales $1.75, one-third, one-quarter. In this equation, 175 is the retail price of the book. One-third is the discount given to booksellers, and one-quarter is the commission that Lippincott earns for each sale. On the publisher's end, this commission amounts to 29.5 cents per copy sold, so that Lippincott would have earned $118 from the 400 copies initially sold, and more than $150 for the 537 copies sold over the life of the book. Within Lippincott and Company, the job printing department played a significant role in terms of publication and revenue. So as I was looking through these records, there are countless other titles in them that are entered in this same way, printed with a one-third discount to retailers and a one-quarter commission, suggesting that they were printed on a commission as opposed to with a sort of royalty payment. In other words, when you look at the accounting records, you can see a certain style is for royalty payments and a certain style is for commission printing. The question of whether such commission printing was exploitative, I think, is actually open to debate. In correspondence, Ruiz de Burton questioned the amount she owed the company, wondering how she was still indebted to them after her novel sold more than 500 copies. Certainly in this relationship, the publishing house always won. Yet at the same time, company records show that books such as Who Would Have Thought It received all sorts of care and benefits in being published by J.B. Lippincott. Ruiz de Burton ultimately paid less than half the cost of production for a book that was given the imprimatur of a major U.S. publisher. This book was sold and distributed throughout the country, and Lippincott kept remaining copies of the book on hand and for sale for more than 25 years. It was shipped to friends, editors, and booksellers free of charge at Ruiz de Burton's command. Although the company did not spend money to advertise Ruiz de Burton's novel in outside publications or periodicals, they listed her book in their own catalog and in advertisements appended to the back of comparable Lippincott novels. Moreover, if Ruiz de Burton had ever paid the remaining amount owed to the company, which at the end was only $30 or $40, she would have owned the stereotype plates and the copyright of the novel, which sort of went along with them at the time. In all these ways, Ruiz de Burton was able to express herself in a volume of literary fiction that would not easily disappear from the world. As I move toward a conclusion here, I want to return briefly to the content of the novel itself. How might this history of the book affect our understanding of the text? For one thing, while Who Would Have Thought It has often been understood by literary critics in terms of sentimental and domestic writing, the context of the Lippincott catalog indicates that the book is much better understood within the genre of sensationalism. Lippincott published a range of sensational titles at this time, particularly novels by Ouida and translations of the German novelist E. Marlitt. Published alongside these books and manufactured to look like them, customers purchasing Who Would Have Thought It would have recognized the novel as sensational fiction, if nothing else. As Jesse Alamon and Shelley Strebe describe, sensational literature is more outrageous and less respectable than sentimental literature, more concerned with exotic foreign spaces than the domestic sphere, making an excellent archive of popular fantasies and fears about U.S. imperialism. Ruiz de Burton understood that sensationalism, a genre that had always criticized genteel culture, would serve as a useful vehicle for her own critique of white womanhood and manifest destiny. The genre also allowed Ruiz de Burton to offer meta-commentary on depictions of California and the frontier, which had stereotypically been treated as sensational. Ruiz de Burton's innovation, then, was not so much to parody the sentimental novel, but to turn the lens of sensationalism back upon the U.S., so that the nation's own myths of purity and whiteness become illicit material. I would also suggest that the narrative voice of the text emerges covertly as that of a Latina speaker. So in general, the novel is written from a third-person omniscient perspective, moving freely among various characters' subjectivities. At times, however, the narrator steps in to offer more explicit commentary on the events taking place. And here's one example. In chapter 8 of the novel, the narrator considers what thoughts might be passing through the mind of Mrs. Norwell's sister, Lavinia Sprigg. This reflection on Lavinia is then answered with another question. Quién sabe? Passage is the first time in the novel that the narrator breaks the third-person omniscient perspective and interjects by posing a question directly to the reader. And significantly, this interjection itself is given in Spanish, quién sabe? The narrator is thus introduced to the reader as Latino, posing a direct question in Spanish, and the question itself is an important one, who knows? It echoes the book's title, Who Would Have Thought It? Reiterating the novel's epistemological concerns and the ways identity and knowledge intertwine. This question, which is repeated several times in the novel, is answered by the outsider status of the Spanish-speaking narrator. In other words, as the book offers a sensational parody of American culture, an implied response to the title, Who Would Have Thought It, is proffered through its underlying Mexican-American consciousness. Indeed, this was the central authorial strategy of Ruiz de Burton as she published her work anonymously, yet in the English language. Her novels aim to draw unsuspecting readers into the narrative and to direct them gradually toward the perspective of the Mexican-American writer. Ruiz de Burton's publication through J.B. Lippincott thus reflects her liminal relationship to the U.S. nation as it overtook Mexican territories. The border status of the job-printed novel, a publication that is not fully within the publication department, can be compared to the border status of Ruiz de Burton as an American. Indeed, her relationship with Lippincott as a job printer links her to other ethnic authors from the mid-19th century who self-financed publication in hopes of making money and spreading their message. I'm thinking particularly of early African-American author Harriet Wilson. Ruiz de Burton's novel tried to imagine a marriage between Mexico and America, a future that would cross racial and national boundaries. While this publication came at a price, did not garner the reception Ruiz de Burton had hoped, and nevertheless ensured that her book was well manufactured, distributed across the nation, and that it would survive. Thank you.